Today, talk a little bit about Hamnet. Who knows of you about Hamnet? Oh, nearly all of you. So we could skip this and go to the beer. No. Hamnet is an amateur radio high-speed network, which was founded somewhere Germany or Austria. The name is from Austria, but the idea popped up at different places at the same time, about 8 years ago. And basically, we're talking about what can be done and what cannot be done with Hamnet. And if you like, we can do some basic link planning, and I can show you some tools for link planning and how it's done. So what is Hamnet? Hamnet is basically a community network. You maybe know other community networks. And I have to make a disclaimer. The content of these slides are not valid on all countries equally. In the US, there are different rules. In Belgium, there are different rules. And so you can't apply the content in every country. So a popular community network is Funkfeuer of Freifunk, where you have ISM network. This is not ham radio at all, but maybe more popular to you. You have links. The green one is are the backbone links, and the access around are the stations of the users. And the same principle works for Hamnet. You have backbone network, and you have users who connect to the backbone network. And the only difference at Freifunk or Funkfeuer, you have mesh network, so users connect to each other, and that's not possible at the Hamnet. We come to this later. So, what is Hamnet? Hamnet is a wireless-based network, mostly on IEEE 802.11a, a, c, b, g, n. And we are using all bands where we have the bandwidth we need to make broadband connections. That's beginning on 2.4 gigahertz and going up to 10 gigahertz. Depending on the local law, we have different regions, but we always can find regions where we connect to each other. And the hardware is really cheap. You start with 70 euros and go up to some 100 euros for a link connection. But in general, one link connection is relatively cheap compared to commercial big hardware. So we saw Freifunk and or Funkfeuer. What are the advantages of Hamnet or amateur radio? You can use higher power. At ISM, you only can emit 200 milliwatts or 1 watt at 5 gigahertz. We have different laws, so we can emit a large power, and so we can use longer distances. At least in Austria, we can do any modulation we like. We only have to publish the modulation. And we can build our own transceivers with SDRs or anything we like. Mostly the hardware is out of the stock from the store, but we are allowed to do it. And if when we like, we can do a network over DVB-S modulation. As a private person without the ham radio license, you're not allowed to do this. So this is a part of Europe, including Hungary. We are somewhere here. And there would be a ham radio connection inside, but there is no user access. You can see the U. There are some stations with a U that indicates user access. So we have Austria, Hungary and parts of Germany. And you see a lot of connections. The blue connects the blue. The blue is the backbone network, and you can connect to the stations with an U on the icon. That's only part, and we come to the big map in the end. So at the Hamnet, we are using 44.000/8 network, parts of it. A part of it is announced in the internet, so can't be used on Hamnet, but it's coordinated and yeah, a little bit of mess, but it gets better. The routing in the network is based on BGP, using private 16-bit and 32-bit AS numbers. This is also coordinated. If you want to build a station, build a region, there will be a range for the AS numbers. And the big difference between ham radio and ISM, it's an internet for ham radio user, ham radio operators. And as you could see on the map, Hungary is not connected wireless to Austria or Slovenia. So there is a tunnel over the internet. Not the other way around. In amateur radio, you can't use internet over ham radio. That's not allowed in any country. So that's one of the limitations of ham radio. We don't have encryption on the network, so everybody can see the network traffic. And we don't have internet over ham radio in general. That applies to Hamnet as well as every other modulation or kind of transmission. And we have limited RF bandwidth. So on 5.5 gigahertz, we're not allowed to do 40 megahertz channels or 80 megahertz channels. So mostly we use 5 or 10 or 20 megahertz channels, also applying to the local law. So what can it be used for? Interconnecting old amateur radio services like APRS, that's a telemetry system, where can you send your position with your handheld, packet radio, old data network, voice repeaters, analog, D-Star, DMR, whatever you want. Remote stations, so you can remote control your repeater, or you can remote control your shortwave station over Hamnet. And WebSDR, so you have a receiver somewhere which receives over huge bandwidth, and you can use this as a remote receiver to check your transmission or to check the how far your wave goes. Yeah, some other stuff: chatting, voice, websites, and webcams. Or anything else you can do on IPv4. So make some hands-on on link planning, if you like, and see what else is possible. Oh. So when we look to Europe, it's spreading from the north to the south, and there are even some islands in the USA and somewhere in the southeast. And let's come back to Hungary. So if there would be an user access at this station, we can right click on there and say snap to the station and place the other side right to the camp. And look if there is a profile possible. So there is nothing between the transceiver or the station and here. So we can see there is 137 dB loss. And we can use this to calculate the hardware we need to connect these two points. But we can do something different. I need a little bit more screen resolution. Lost. Sorry, my trackpad. Here. And we can simulate the visibility from points. Sorry, the trackpad is not working. So, yeah, we have two different points. Basically, you can put two points on the map, the red cross and the blue cross, start the simulation, and then you see with the color which area you can reach. That makes it very easy to plan access points or link connections, so to expand the network or plan new link points. Come back to the presentation in the last few slides. I showed you the link between the ham radio station, Hotel Alpha 2 Kilo Delta Radio, and the camp. This is would be 31 kilometers. And when we fill these parameters into the formula at the bottom right, we get the loss, 136 decibel. And when we put on the other side the gain of the antenna and the transmitter, we get the signal at the receiver. And this would be minus 68 dBm. And that would be very suitable for a connection. And when you imagine, yeah, what kind of hardware are we using? When you look outside on the roof or at the camp over there, there is this small antenna dish. That's exactly the hardware we use for links or for user access. Basically, that's it. If we have any questions. Yeah, and an important one, if you don't have an amateur radio license, get one.
No. You mentioned the services you can run over MNET, like IRC and everything. How do you do that in your area? So, how do you collect what services are available? Where do you host these services?
Yes, I have to look. No, I can't do this. My mouse is dying. I don't know why. We have a kind of, we call it index server, where you can put into it, you can make an entry for a new service, and everybody can see this. And there is something new in the back at the Hamnet DB, where we manage the whole IP addresses. We want to attach the services to the IP addresses, so that everybody can see all the services, can search for them, and can easily access them. And your second question about the hosting, we have some servers where there's a lot of services on them, but we have also club stations and smaller infrastructure where local guys want to host a weather station or some SDR or something.
And at least in Austria, the law might change, and then we are allowed to interconnect properly with the internet.
Yeah, but only for remote control.
Yeah, but it would be more remote control then.
Yes?
So Kiwi SDR is doing like 29 megahertz of bandwidth, if you're looking into that. And you said you can do web SDR over this.
Exactly.
And I don't know how that works really, but I would expect that this be more than 29 megahertz of bandwidth.
The Kiwi SDR for a user needs about 2 or 3 megabits.
Oh, yeah, for a user, of course.
And so this is not a problem. You can't use the whole, you can't stream the whole 29 megahertz of a network with the Kiwi SDR.
Okay.
You can only attach, I think, 4 users to it.
Oh.
That are 8 streams.
Okay.
4 for voice or audio, and the other 4 for the visual FFT.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Where do you see Hamnet in 5 years?
Hungary connected to the rest of the world. And yeah, some connected links in Austria and Germany so that we don't need so much VPN connections.
Do you have a lot of those in Austria and Germany?
Yes. Some are only for backup, and some are, you need some of them. We can enable them. The mouse is dying. A little bit difficult. Basically, we can make them. So the gray lines are VPN connections. And you can see here the connection to Croatia. And what country is this?
Romania
and, Romania. And there are other islands in Austria. There is no connections between Vorarlberg and Tyrol. This goes also with 2 VPN connections. And there are a lot of VPN connections for backup. And we are monitoring all the, or not all of them, but many of them, of the links, the signal strength, and if it gets too low, we can activate the VPN so that there is no interruption.
So what are the fix and the general cost, like the cost that you have over to maintain this thing for a long time? And how much does the hardware cost that you have to invest into this?
That's depending.
For one node?
For a user to connect to it, it's about 70 euros.
OK. No, but I mean these nodes.
These nodes, there at the bottom, there's one red. This one, there died the router board, the main router.
Is
so
the
on the Sonnblick, hoher Sonnblick, 3000 Meter. Hoher Sonnblick, 3,000 meters, 3,000 meters above sea level. A little bit ugly to get there. This would be, I think, an investment of 100 euros, 150.
The hardware.
To renew the router.
Oh, okay.
But in general, to make a node with 2 connections only, I think 300 euros if it's made well. And this should last for, I don't know, I expect 6 years without anything. But we have some of them who work much longer, derail, and some of them dies after 2 years if it's a bad hardware.
Is it solar powered, or
no, it's
do you always need to have some kind of...
Some of the nodes are solar powered, but they are not done well. So if there is winter time or rainy week, they don't work. It would be possible, but we nearly have none of them.
A bit connected to that last question, since ham radio has one of these things attached to it that it's great for when everything else dies, how much is it the general thought that these nodes have some kind of backup power?
That's a funny question, or the circumstances are not so funny. If you have a big battery with hundreds of ampere hours for 12 volts, you put them there, announce you have this great backup for 4 days or something, and then it stands there for the next 10 years, and nobody touches it. That could be a problem at some nodes. But other nodes, there is a great system of the building, because they need to heat the building, otherwise it freezes. We can rely on this for 1 day, and then we have a battery for another 2 days. We are better than the state radio service. At other nodes, I plant the battery for 4 days and say it works for free. And after 6 years, I have to change the battery. I can put it to the shack, the battery, and use it there, but at the mountain, I have to change it. And the awareness of battery cycles and changing them gets better. But I can't say it for whole Austria or whole Europe. The good thing that it works. If your node works, you can use this one node and you're not depend on any other thing. But on the other way around, if you have a long trace, we had one from Bodensee to somewhere middle Germany, 23 hops at the ham radio fair in June, and if one of them dies, the connection is dead. Not everywhere is N-1 security. We are planning this, but it's difficult, or a lot of work.
Okay, and then another question. You mentioned how many purposes it can be used for.
There are only examples.
Yeah. Precisely because these were examples, I'd be interested in what you or people you know use Hamnet right now.
The examples are coming from this, what we are using. I use it nearly daily for chatting.
So you have an IRC server
there? Yeah, more or less. I have an IRC connected to the packet radio system. A packet radio was an old
AX25.
Yes, exactly. Where you can use a handheld to connect to the network and make text messages or very small files.
Okay, and can you access that IRC, for example, from the internet? So where does that low stop? Because
we do this intentionally. And basically, we say everything which goes over HF stays on HF. So if you want to reach from Hungary to the North Sea, it should be the best way over HF. At the best, no internet between Hungary and the North Sea. That's the basic idea. If you have central services like a DNS server or a time server, or central services like the HamnetDB, there is the so-called Ham Cloud. And you can't see it on the projector, but there are blue nodes, and the blue nodes are connected to the Ham Cloud. And if you access something in the Ham Cloud, it goes the shortest way to the next blue one, and then to the internet.
Ones are connected to the internet as well?
Yes, to the Ham Cloud over VPN to a data center with three sites across Germany. And that's, yeah. That's for centralized stuff which you can't put to a distributed network. Or for high, very high availability.
So assuming that Hungary will be connected to Austria, will it be possible to like send packets from Hungary to the Netherlands?
Of course.
Okay. How
many in the best, in the best case,
I
yes.
Mean directly over, no, not touching the internet, only up.
That's the basic idea, yes. In the moment, probably we can go up to at least Middle Germany. I don't know if it goes to Aachen at the moment, and then to the Netherlands. No, there is no connection over HF.
Oh, you have a Hamnet node in Bielefeld?
But that's impossible.
There's no Bielefeld.
That's not the same.
There, everything stops.
But
stop right
yeah.
there. Go a bit down.
And hands.
Okay, that's good. That's exactly where I want to connect to.
The law in the Netherlands is a little bit ugly. At least 2 years ago, they hadn't the same possibilities as in Germany or Austria. They weren't not allowed to make the high bandwidth. I don't know if it has changed or.
Is it possible to be a user in the Netherlands and connect to a node on the border in Germany?
If you're not breaking the law in the Netherlands. I don't care, you have to care.
I don't have a license.
Also,
it's okay. I can do anything.
The authorities care, I mean.
I mean, you're physically operating in Germany.
The authorities care very much because of you have to license every office link. Because of the. We had problems before with the NATO networks for the NATO direct links for their communication.
On Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
It's depending on the national authority. Some of them are stronger, or some of them don't care.
Welcome to the bar.
And then you have that there are other users who don't care about the law, not ham radio users, like commercial ones, and that's all which plays into one big game.
But I mean, it all seems too fuzzy to me. For instance, you said that there is no encryption allowed, but which kind of authority has the equipment and resources to tap into point-to-point connections, because at least one part of these links is a heavily narrow beam, so you'd actually have to have someone get between the two and then monitor packets going at high bandwidth. Yeah, I think that's encrypted. It has a really high entropy, so who cares about this? Which kind of authority in which country?
I only
there's a good watch that you can use for that.
I only can tell from the Austrian authorities, at least they have equipment to turn down the bandwidth, what's not possible with standard equipment, and look for the SSID and look if there is a ham radio call or not.
Wow.
They have done this and they have remarked to operators who were not operating it regarding the law.
They have too much time.
Nice.
I have a funny story to this, because the links you have to register by the government.
Yeah.
So they can, this was a German link, and the government came to measure the link. And they looked at the link and looked at their paper on which frequency it was registered. And they said, oh, we don't have equipment for this, and went back to home.
So, yes. We have one.
It's a little bit Wild West at the moment.
We have one 10 gigahertz link.
That's what I tried to convince by my comments.
We have one 10 gigahertz link. I don't know if they would be able to monitor this, because the hardware is very expensive.
Yeah, also I heard that last year there was the first 47 gigahertz QSO between a Hungarian and an Austrian operator, so we have some developments on that front as well.
Yeah, but it would probably not suitable for OFDM, that hardware.
Not yet.
How much is a 10 gigahertz link cost?
This one is was very new when it came out 6 years ago. I don't know the cost, but over 1K.
I think Roland will
make it. This is the small one, huh?
This is the small one, yes. On this hardware, you have two limitations. At first, you have only very little output power. And the second one goes into the equation here, over, right over there. If there is a small wavelength, you have more attenuation. Yeah, that's it.